for having me.
Of course. So next we're going to bring up Carol Bornstein, who we just had. She's our Southern, she's one of our board members, and she will be introducing tonight's speakers.
Thank you again, Erin. I'm delighted to be able to introduce the speakers for our program this evening. And I'm actually doing this on behalf of Susan Gottlieb. Susan regrets that she was not able to perform this function for us this evening. And yet she is really the driver behind this whole program because she published the book, California in a Vase. Many of you probably know Susan because of her fabulous native garden here in Los Angeles, and author of several books about her own garden as well. She had this desire for a long time to publish a book about how to use native plants in flower arranging. And I think it was at a program at the California Botanic Garden where there were a lot of floral designs decorating the event that made her realize that that was going to be the collaboration that would get this book into print, that she would work with the staff and the volunteers at the Botanic Garden to publish the book, which I don't know if Lucinda or Linda are going to hold it up. And so I have a copy here. So there you go. You can see the cover of it. And so we have to thank Susan for helping to bring this book to all of us. And so from there, I'll just introduce our two speakers. Lucinda McDade is the executive director of the California Botanic Garden, which is the largest botanic garden in the state of California devoted to California native plants. She's a botanist and is highly regarded for all of the research work that she has done over the many years. In fact, she recently was honored by the American Horticultural Society with their highest honor. It's called the Liberty Hyde Bailey Award, and that's in recognition of her research work, her work as the director of the Botanic Garden, and the teaching that she has done over the years, to all of her contributions to the world of horticulture and gardening. So she will be with us this evening, as will Linda Prendergast. And Linda has a very long career in the world of horticulture herself. She was a grower at one point in the wholesale nursery industry. She was a plant buyer for retail garden centers. I think it was back in college that she worked in flower shops as a florist. And after she retired, she began volunteering at the California Botanic Garden with the Native Designs, the volunteer group called Native Designs, and she's the crew leader of all of these volunteers who create these fabulous floral arrangements for all kinds of events at the Botanic Garden. So I will turn it over to Lucinda and Linda.
Great. Can you hear me, everybody? Thumbs up, somebody. Wonderful. thank you, Carol. You just gave our introduction, which basically was to start by saying that this we're here today with you as a result of an intersection of two phenomena, one being the Native Designs group here at California Botanic Garden, and the other being Susan Gottlieb and her magnificent interest in native plants. I'm going to go to share screen and show you just a couple of images that I think you will enjoy. Let's see, how do I get to full screen on this thing? Can everybody see that okay? Are you seeing my screen okay or no?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay. So the Native Designs group here at California Botanic Garden, as Carol said, is a group of intrepid volunteers who have been doing this for more than a dozen years. And they are an absolute terrific group. And you're going to see some of what they do tonight, thanks to Linda Prendergast. Let's see. I'm not in my normal slide showing, and I'm looking for the right icon to project this properly. If anybody knows where it is, let me know.
Lucinda, you might be able to right click on the image.
I'm on a Mac, so nobody knows what right click is on a Mac.
I don't know either. If anyone,
I'll figure it out, or we'll I think we can keep going. No, cool. All right. No.
Oh, at the top, where it says present, top right.
Top right. Present. Yeah, good. Thank you. So California in a Vase with Linda and Lucinda. I already said that. Let's go to the next one. So the Native Designs group, here they are in action at the garden. They have maintained a cuttings garden out toward the back of our Mesa area. This is an important Native designer, Carol Petty, working on a big sunflower, as you can see. Here they are in our nursery area where they actually do the prep work after they cut the plants. The arrangement that started it all, actually, as Carol alluded to, Susan Gottlieb, who's a wonderful native plant enthusiast, we're very fortunate to have her in her capacity as a philanthropist in supporting native plants. And she received this arrangement from us and immediately fell in love. Apparently, she had been arranging with non-native plants and the occasional native plant mixed in, and she realized that really this the native plants were something very, very special. And so eventually, after quite a long process, but a fun, mostly fun process, we ended up producing this wonderful book that Carol has just shown you, California in a Vase. We have it for sale here at the garden for a very affordable price, and we could easily send anybody a box of them if you would like. Here's Linda. This is when it first got published. Yes, those are champagne glasses. We were very, very, very happy. Carol Petty, Linda's partner in crime, me looking very darkly shaded, and Lily Colton, who was the book designer, wonderful book designer. She did just a terrific job on it. She was great to work with. So for today's arrangements, Linda is going to create two for you. And I should just say that Linda Prendergast, I didn't get to this in time because I should say that it should be Linda Prendergast and Lucinda McDade. I'm really just Linda's popularizer. I'm her botanical spokesperson. I'm the plant scientist who explained some of what she is doing. And so please view Linda as the real star, and I'm just her sidekick. I think Linda's gonna start her part by telling you a bit about her background and how she came to this. And then she's going to do two arrangements for you. One being a seasonal color arrangement with a lot of yellow, as you'll see, and the other being a Christmas arrangement. And so I think, Linda, go ahead and take it away.
Well, okay. Hello, everybody. I'm Linda Prendergast, and taking a look at the arrangements that were on display on your screens earlier, you don't need me at all. There's plenty of talent in this group, and you've made some gorgeous arrangements. In preparing for this webinar, I was thinking back on my career and realized it's been 50 years ago that I started in the floral industry, and nobody starts out as a designer. I started out delivering flowers in a van before there was GPS, using the Thomas Brothers map book. I washed and sanitized buckets. I conditioned flowers. I made bows. I have made thousands of bows over my career. I swept the floor. I dressed chrysanthemums. I dressed azaleas. I dressed Easter lilies, and I dressed poinsettias with cellophane and with bows. And I prepared makeup bowls for the real designers. And back in my day, all of the bowls were made of glass. So there were no plastics at that point, and everything was held in place by a heavy duty adhesive tape. I use a collection of tools. Probably most important are the pruners that we use. I prefer a bypass pruner. Because it gives a nice clean cut when you're out in the field. I discourage the use of an anvil pruner The anvil pruner has a plate on the bottom, and that just kind of crushes the stem, and that keeps the water from going up into the head of the plant. And these are good too. They're nice pointy pruners, and they're good for getting in and cutting out dead berries and damaged leaves and such. Most of the items that we cut are woody. A professional florist is going to use a florist knife like this. And you won't catch a professional florist using many of these tools, because it's just their right-hand tool is the sharpest knife in the drawer. We use picks. We use wired picks like these occasionally to secure perhaps a cluster of acorns. We use a big butcher knife. I use this to cut the oasis with, which I'll explain in a minute. I use a turntable like this so that I can look at the arrangement all the way around. We have, of course, a water can, and we have a spritz bottle to spritz the flowers after they're all arranged to keep them a little bit fresher. The first part of doing the arrangements is, of course, to harvest and condition the plant material. And the varieties, of course, are determined by the season and by the weather. April and May are generally the peak of the flowers out here at California Botanic Garden. We cut in the morning and we put the material into buckets of lukewarm water that has been treated with Floral Life or Crisol. It's a floral preservative that you can get. Well, it comes on all of the bouquets that you buy at Trader Joe's and you buy at the grocery store. But the flower food is important to the natives. They're hungry, so they like to drink this up. You dissolve this completely in the water and then cut from the shrub, walk back to the cart where the bucket is, cut the stem again, and put it down into the water. You always want to clean the stems of the material so that there's no, I can't find my white sage. Here it is. When you cut it from the shrub, it's going to look like this, and it has all of this falderol along the bottom. You want to strip that off, give it a fresh cut, and again, put it into water. But you don't want to have leaves or stems or side shoots underneath the water line, because as that decomposes, it fouls the water and puts bacteria into the water. I would further clean this up. Check it for bugs, check it for gnarly leaves or petals. And when it's all cleaned up, it's ready to use. But again, before I use it, I'm going to put it into deep water. I'm going to use Oasis, which is a floral foam. Oasis needs to soak overnight in water so that it takes up all of the water into the foam itself. And of course, the size of your container determines the quantity of material that you need and the size of the oasis. Here's a block of dry oasis, and as you can see, it is measured into three separate units. And this, each one third fits this commercial makeup bowl that we're going to use. Here's the big butcher knife. I'm going to cut one third of the block. And these bowls have spikes in the bottom down here, which is really handy because you can impale the oasis right on it. You want the oasis name on the top of your block. I'm going to bevel the edges. That just gives me more design faces to stick the flowers and greens in. And I'm going to secure this with tape. Now there's two different kinds of tape that florists use. This is the adhesive tape. It's green, it comes in the quarter inch and it comes in the half inch. Quarter inch is typically what we use. There's also a cellophane tape, and this is clear. And if you're working with a clear vase or a translucent vase, this is nice to do a grid across the top because it does not show on clear glass. We're going to use the narrow adhesive tape.
And Linda, you're doing that kind of to secure the oasis down to the pot. So the whole thing is kind of stable once you get all the plant material in there, right? Because it'll be top, really top heavy.
The one thing you got to think about is if you were a real florist, this is going to go into a delivery truck and bounce around in the back of the truck. And you don't want the foam to come loose and you don't want the arrangement to be ruined because the oasis fell out. So I'm securing this around the edges. There's the bowl. I would add water at that point, and you'll want to add water afterwards too. The natives, when they're freshly cut, are very thirsty. So you want to add water to your arrangement every day.
Early and often. Linda, why does it matter that the oasis has the label facing up?
The manufacturer, that's actually the manufacturer's recommendation. The next arrangement I do, I'm going to put it on the side. It just seems to allow the plant material to soak up the water better. And it's got to be something in the chemical engineering of the oasis. There is I understand, and I haven't used it myself, but I understand there's a biodegradable oasis now, although we've not tried it because we haven't had occasion to yet. That would be a really good thing. The oasis as it sits is not biodegradable. So it goes into the trash. We're gonna start with bay leaves. And as you can see, little bit of gnarly bug damage. That leaf. I don't know what eats them. Lucinda, what eats bay leaves?
Gosh, I don't know. It's very strong. I'm not sure what would, must be some specialized thing.
I'm going to establish the width and the height of the arrangement with the greenery. And you want to impale the plant material down as far as you can. You know, gravity tells you the water is going to stay at the bottom of the bowl. It's going to stay at the bottom of the oasis. So you want to go as deep as you can to keep the material as fresh as you can. No hard and fast rules, but the general rule of thumb is if your container is one-third of the size of your arrangement and you finish it out two-thirds across the top, that would be especially apropos in a vase arrangement. I want to hide the edge of the bowl as best I can. That's just generally green. Now you can see there's holes in there, but that's okay. We have more greenery to go in. I'm gonna use, correct me here, Lucinda, Quercus Kellogg.
Quercus Kelloggii, yep. Black oak.
This is a beautiful oak. It's a deciduous oak, but you can see the fall color on it.
And you can use valley oak also. Our valley oak doesn't look as good as our Kellogg oak, as our black oak does right this minute. So Linda is choosing to use Quercus Kelloggii, the black oak.
Generally odd numbers, five around the base, three in the next level, three pieces of oak. That's not hard and fast. It's whatever looks good to you. And don't be intimidated by the books that tell you, well, you have to have seven of this and five of that and three of this. Just go with your own eye. So there's the bases. Next comes yellow toyon. This usually requires a little bit of cleanup. The birds go after it, and we don't begrudge them that. I'm going to put the berries down low so that they help to hide the edge of the bowl. If you have to take it out to reposition, make sure you give it a fresh cut when you put it back in. You want to avoid sticking it into the oasis, pulling it out, and then sticking it back in.
Because that clogs up the cells that conduct water and keep the plant hydrated and happy. And the yellow toyon is Davis Gold. It's just a cultivar, basically, of or a selection of our native toyon.
Some of the berries get little black spots on them. Not a big deal. Just pinch them off. So the toyon has been added. Next is the Salvia apiana. And this plant is just our workhorse. You can't use it in the springtime because it's just too soft. And of course, this is not the flowers, this is the foliage. But this is one of the few rosettes of any size in the native plant kingdom. And we use it a lot. It really gives us a nice big effect.
But it also has a bit of the downside of fouling the water, right?
Yeah, you can see, I'll hold up the vase. When we harvest this, we always put it in a separate bucket. And when you use it in an arrangement or in a vase, you can see here faintly how the water is colored, a little bit fouled. So if you're doing a clear vase and you're using Salvia apiana, you're gonna wanna change the water probably every day just to keep it looking nice.
And probably all of you know that that white sage is the sage that's favored by our the local indigenous people for making smudges. And unfortunately, it's being harvested off of wildlands. And so one of the things we're really trying to encourage people to do is to grow their own white sage for whatever purpose they're growing it for, whether smudges or wonderful arrangements or whatever it may be. Grow your own. Don't harvest it from the wild. It's a super easy plant to grow, as I know many of you know. The only downside of it is it gets really big and kind of wants to take over a giant chunk of your yard if you're not a bit careful. I love how Linda just yanks off chunks of the plant there to achieve the desired effect.
Rosettes come in, of course, different sizes. Some are larger than the others. You want to put your larger ones down toward the bottom of the bowl, and then your smaller ones, like this one is a little smaller, up a little bit higher.
Otherwise, it'll look weirdly top heavy.
Right.
Linda, are you using your bypass pruner to do this little clipping, or you're using your more pointy one, or you're not using your florist knife?
I'm not using the knife. These stems are too woody.
So which one are you using? The bypass or the, we can't really see.
This is a bypass.
Okay. Thank you.
Most bypasses have the hook nose, the kind of the hawk nose.
Mm-hmm.
It's whatever you like.
But as long as it's sharp.
You know, when we're harvesting, when we go out, we take a spritzer bottle of alcohol, rubbing alcohol with us, and we spritz between cutting every variety so that we're not spreading any bacteria. We cut, we spray, and we move on. But it's important to for cleanliness and sanitary situation for the plant material. This is Rus ovata. You can see it has a nice kind of reddish pink tone. We're going to add just a few of these.
Did you say British pink tone?
Reddish pink. Comes in white too.
You can see why she beveled the edges of the oasis to give more surface area for sticking things in.
This is another one that the bugs like to eat the top leaves. They're probably a little more tender than the others. each flower to have a little bit of definition. When I was coming up in the industry, it was French bouquets were all the rage, and they were mounded, and all the flowers were at basically the same height out of the oasis. They were beautiful. They utilized a lot of jewel tone color flowers. Of course, they were all commercial flowers. But it ended up looking moundy roundy is probably the best way to describe it. I think with the natives, it lends itself better to a meadow type look. The theory here is, and Mother Nature tells you, you want to arrange your arrangement. You want to stick all of your stems in, just like the shape of this agapanthus. It is, of course, everything is facing the middle. It's facing one point. And that gives you the roundness that you need. But as you vary the different stems, it gives you the depth and the individuality of the flowers that makes the arrangement special. We still have the helianthus in bloom. Not a lot of them, but some.
Linda, do you ever reuse oasis? We're having discussion about the fact that oasis that we standardly work with are not biodegradable, and we should probably look into getting that other product. But do you ever reuse them, or is it a problem because they're kind of fouled by the time you?
No, it will not reabsorb water. It won't take water up. So it's not. So
once it's taken up water, yeah, I get that. Yeah.
Taken up water, it's done.
Remember that this is the seasonal color arrangement, and kind of yellow is the color of fall. So that's why you chose the yellow, the Davis gold, right, Linda? Because it goes with the color theme for this arrangement versus the standard, far more standard red one.
You know, if you were in a regular flower shop, you could have any color in the world, any color that you wanted, because commercial flowers are grown year round and available year round.
And they also dye them, which is terrifying.
Oh, that's awful. Yeah, they're frightening them too. Okay. One of the things that we use on occasion are water tubes. And this is a water tube. It's a plastic tube. It has a little rubber cap on it that we're not going to use. But flowers with very tender stems, like Baylia, Desert Marigold, and California poppies, are just not strong enough to impale into the oasis. So we're gonna put the Baylia into this tube of water. Now you have to go back and add water to this every single day, but then we're gonna put the Baylia right smack in the middle.
Either you add water or you throw away the Baylia.
Yes, exactly.
And probably adding water keeps it nicer longer. But
yes.
Boy, that's one thing that I just so favor about our native plant arrangements is that they last forever compared to a commercial one. Even if you have to jettison a thing or two. And Linda, we're going to have to get you to pull it out a little bit away from the cedar there when you're done, just so that we can. It's right now it's hiding behind the greenery of the next arrangement, but that's good. That's perfect, actually.
Okay.
I don't know how many of you grow Baylia, but it can be just a terrific plant. If you get it started, oftentimes it reseeds and actually will perennate.
It's in bloom almost all year round.
Yeah, and it's in bloom, yeah. Wow.
Now you want to remember with a centerpiece, your guests at your table are going to be seeing it from a sitting down. They're going to be sitting down. So you want to make sure the edge of the bowl is hidden, that your tape is hidden. If you've used any water tubes or water picks, you want to make sure that that is hidden. We call that hiding your underwear. Any of your support items or your mechanics should not show.
Or else you're like the Wizard of Oz behind when the curtain gets pulled back, which may be a terrifically, terribly mixed metaphor. Apologies to those of you with delicate ears.
So go back and you're going to check for any holes and check that you don't have any of your mechanics showing.
So we have a question about how long an arrangement like this would last. And I would, if I had it on my desk here, it would be still beautiful at least a week.
About a week, that's right. The more water you add, the longer it'll last.
Right, yeah, changing the water daily. Keep it out of the super direct sun. Don't let it dry out. Tend it a little bit so that if something hasn't been shoved in well enough to make contact with good water, you know, you might have to jettison a piece or two, but, you know, it will stay for a long time. I actually often end up getting rid of the kind of more delicate things, but still holding on to the core of the arrangement, because I just think they're so beautiful and they smell so good. And when I look at them, they make me feel happy. And so to me, it keeps being beautiful for a long time. And then, Linda, that thing, you call it a makeup tray. Where do you get those things?
The standard makeup bowls are available at Floral Supply Syndicate, and Floral Supply Syndicate is a floral supply house, and there's branches all over the place. So we have one in Upland here. I believe there's probably some in LA, and also
yeah, there's one in San Diego. I know I looked that up a little while ago. In fact, Linda, you have a holiday lookbook catalog from Floral Supply Syndicate that's on my desk right this minute. If I remember, I'll give it to you.
And Michaels and Hobby Lobby can help. Or if you have your own bowl, I mean, you can use Oasis in your grandmother's Lalique or Waterford. Just be careful that you don't scratch it or leave adhesive on it.
Yeah, you don't always need the makeup tray, right? You can use it. You can use other things. Yeah, you do it in other things. And then Erin asks about offering classes. We've offered a variety of things. Actually, during the time of peak COVID, we offered three times a workshop that we called Arrange Wild, and people would come. We would basically make a full kit for each person, with a pail that had all of the cut plant material in it, and then a bag that had the, you know, all of the other things that you need, the tape and the marbles and the vase and whatever else. Those were very successful, and people really, really enjoyed them. We're kind of where we are now is we're in a bit of a transition to doing it in person. That's what we think we're likely to do, is go to a more in-person arrangement. Because it's actually a huge amount of work for us to make all of the individual items that people need in order to participate. But we may well do kind of a hybrid thing where we actually send out a materials list so that someone who lived a little further away could attempt to gather all of the materials and then do it themselves. I'll say something amusing, which is that some of our participants in the Arrange Wild Zoom workshops, they loved the Zoom related to the fact that no one could see their arrangement. And that would be me. I would be saying, oh, good, no one can see my arrangement. I can just keep going along. Linda, let me share screen and just work quickly through the plant materials that you just used. And I will then preview the ones that we will be using. Is that the one? No, that's not the one. Hold on a second. Let me get to my screen. I just want to quickly review the plants that we have looked at. If it will let me do that, please. Okay, never mind. Go keep carry on, Linda. We'll come back to that in a minute once I get a few.
In the interest of time, I'm going to kind of whip through. This is a Christmas arrangement with a candle in the middle, and I have prepared the candle by taping wooden picks to the bottom of it, the half inch oasis tape, and I'm cutting it to about the depth of the oasis, the picks, and then impaling the picks right in the middle down into the oasis to hold it steady. Now the I cut the wick to 1/4 inch, because when you light a candle that has a wick longer than 1/4 inch, it tends to smoke. So you want to have it a little bit shorter. This again, larger container, almost a whole piece of oasis, although cut on one end, and the oasis is set up on the edge. This is for a dining table, a narrow centerpiece. And again, the colors that you would choose would depend on your tablecloth color, the decor in your home. I don't think you would want to use this yellow seasonal arrangement on a Christmas table.
So the incense cedar goes in.
Incense cedar is so graceful.
Linda, this is Erin. While you are putting that together, I am just going to give a brief announcement. So for anyone who does have to leave at 8:30, make sure to keep an eye out for this recording, which will be on our YouTube channel, at least by early next week. And we will also have the slides provided that Lucinda had provided for us. So we'll also have those available to you. And make sure to mark your calendars for next year. Our next webinar, that's kind of crazy to say, it's going to be a hybrid webinar. And I assure you, it will be a great webinar virtually and in person too. So we are going to be hosting Arlene Ferreira of Satori Garden Design from Los Angeles, who will be presenting a program on horticultural therapy. So that will be the second Thursday of January, January 13th. It will be in person at the Friendship Auditorium, and also virtually over Zoom. And so if you can't join us, make sure to join us virtually, right? And we thank anyone who does have to leave, who can't stay. Thank you for joining us tonight. Keep an eye out for this recording. We're gonna keep going with Linda's Christmas decorations, or excuse me, Christmas arrangement. Linda, by the way, you are just a magic woman. I've been so entranced watching your hands move and put all of those, just put everything together. It's been incredible. And I would be that same person with you, Lucinda, not showing anyone my arrangement on the camera.
Linda, someone says that that Floral Supply Syndicate is wholesale only.
No, the public can go into Floral Supply Syndicate. Different price, that there's two prices posted. One is for the trade and one is for regular consumer.
And then there's a question about using oasis versus just arranging into a vase in water with marbles or whatever.
In a regular vase like this, I would grid the top with adhesive or with the clear cellophane tape, and then I would fill the base with marbles, and you buy the marbles at the 99 cent store. And that, when you put the stems down in, you want to go down into the marbles so it holds the stem upright along with the grid across the top. I'm getting faint.
You're getting faint?
Yes. If I fall down, come pick me up.
Don't say that. We don't want you to go down.
I've put in some pine. This is Douglas fir. If you are hesitant to cut your pines and cut anything from a tree, which I am, you can buy these greens right now at Trader Joe's, and you don't have to cut your own.
Wow, that's already beautiful. Everybody knows Doug Fir with the beautiful little pitchfork cones. They're just so gorgeous.
And that came off of our trees here at the garden.
Also extremely informative in terms of the evolutionary development of pine cones, but that's a different topic. You'll have to take my class in evolutionary plant systematics to get that. So this is a holiday arrangement with the emphasis on evergreens and the beautiful red calendar candle, right? And you can imagine putting this on the table in your entryway or something like that. Or on the table, the dining room table. And then when you eat, you move it away so that people can see each other.
Yes, that's one thing you always want to make sure of with any centerpiece. You've got to be able to see over the top so that your guests know who else is at the table. You've seen in the decor magazines, the gigantic arrangement, you know, they're 18, 20 inches tall in the middle of a dining room table. And how are you gonna tell who's across the way? How are you gonna talk to them? It looks great for a photo shoot, but it's not practical.
Yeah, you don't want your guests having to stand up to look over the arrangement to talk to each other. That's awkward.
This is, Pinus quadrifolia, and it adds a nice kind of a touch of blue-gray.
Yeah, it's bluish green for sure. One of our pinyon pines.
Pinyon.
And then the book, the California in a Vase book, is organized by seasons and provides some suggestions, including materials lists of arrangements that you can make at all four seasons of the year, which, as we all know, in California, the seasons are not quite what the rest of the country thinks of as normal. But you can make beautiful arrangements. You just have to kind of tame them down a bit for the late summer and early fall, when before we've had rain, nothing is doing much of anything. But that's when it's a little challenging, but you can still make gorgeous arrangements with native plants. At that time of the year, our native designers, our volunteer group, get very, very pensive about not wishing to cut too much from the garden because they don't want to damage plants when they're very stressed by the fact that usually we haven't had any rain since May or April. And so there you're working with juniper?
Our visual interest, a couple of stems of junipers with the berries.
I can almost smell this arrangement, even though my office is down the floor, down the aisle from the room that Linda is in, so that we can both be unmasked.
And then last but not least is a touch
our of toyon.
Red toyon.
And the red one. See, it's great to have both varieties. So if you can fit both a yellow, a Davis Gold, and a red in your yard, because they can get quite large, get one of each so you have one for your fall color and one for your seasonal color and one for your holiday arrangement. Wow. I want that.
When you're all finished working with the pine or the Douglas fir, you're going to have pine pitch on your hands. And you can clean your hands using olive oil.
Olive oil.
Olive oil.
Wow. I feel like I should have known that, but I actually didn't. Does it have to be extra virgin or is just virgin okay?
Absolutely, extra virgin. Okay, what do we think? Are we finished?
Now, how will you know if you're finished? I'm not supposed to ask you that kind of question.
As long as you don't have any holes. Ah, I see the tape on my candle.
That's not good. And Cynthia, yeah, we have a nice color. The red is just beautiful here, isn't it? But I also like the brown of the Doug fir cone. I think that makes an interest and also just as spiky, a different texture around the edges of it. I really like that.
This is an organic arrangement. You could go glitzy. You could put shiny stem balls in it. Or, you know, glittered branches that you buy at Michael's. It all depends on. These are commercial pine cones they have sticks already glued to them. If you wanted to pick up your own pine cones, you would just put a heavy duty wire on them, wrap it around, and then impale the wire into the oasis.
Nice.
Okay.
That's gorgeous.
And again, everything is just centered on that candle. And the thing that's good about Christmas greens is you don't want to get too busy. You don't need to have all the different flavors in the world. The tablecloth, again, if you had a nice red plaid tablecloth or whatever, would really set this off, or anything in chartreuse green would be pretty. So you want it loose.
Chartreuse green? I guess you're right.
Sage green? How about sage green?
Okay, sage green. Don't yank that off the table, though. That'll be bad.
Don't argue with me, Lucinda.
I won't argue with you. You're always right.
So that's it. You're going to design for fragrance, for texture, negative space. You're seeing it from the side, hide your underwear, and then just enjoy it. Make sure you spritz it with water frequently. Spritz, 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 spritz. Sure.
And that's just plain water, not with that florist stuff in it.
No, that's just plain water.
And I like to use rainwater.
Rainwater would be marvelous. And then add water to the container daily with a long nose watering can so that you don't spill it all over. The other thing you don't ever want to forget when you are putting any arrangement on a table, no matter what the container is put a saucer underneath. This is a saucer. You could use a plate, whatever, but make sure that you are protecting the wood. Jen, could you move this one? Just pull that away. Protect the wood or the top of the table.
Yes, you don't want water running all over your beautiful table. Like my husband did with the pumpkin one year that decomposed from the bottom onto the table. Linda, someone says you're a magician, and I completely agree.
Thank you.
That's absolutely fantastic. Linda, show them the book again, just so that everybody knows. And if you contact us, we will be happy to mail you one for a very affordable price. And we can send if there's a group of you in one place, we're happy to send you a box, which makes it extremely effective and cost effective in terms of getting it to you. Or you can visit us and pick a copy up. I will provide the PowerPoint to Erin so that she can share it with you. It will just give you in written sort of form a list of the materials for each of the arrangements that Linda, for both of the arrangements that Linda made, as well as an individual sort of slide with the scientific name and the common name of each of the plants that she used. Almost all of them, essentially all of them, are available in the trade one place or the other, and so you know, you can grow them in your yard. Again, we very strongly recommend growing your own or share with a friend or something of that nature. Please don't harvest from nature. As you all know, that's not a good thing to do. Leave the flowers for the next person to see. Don't you agree with me that our native designers are just absolutely amazing?
Thank you.
I agree. And you guys have gotten a lot of really great comments in the chat as well. Utterly charming presenters, lovely arrangements, and very helpful commentary. I kind of sound like a movie critic right now, but these are all the great things that people are saying. And this has been a very informative, inspiring, and just mesmerizing. I've just been watching Linda's hands without blinking practically. So thank you both for such a lovely presentation, and especially going into the holidays. If you make an arrangement, please make sure to tag us so that we can also tag SoCal Hort and also tag CalBG as well, or California Botanic Garden.
Either one.
The official name. Yeah. And we would love to see all of your creations. So thank you everyone for joining us tonight. Thank you, Linda and Lucinda, for this great teamwork that you guys presented. And we appreciate all of your efforts. And we hope everyone has a very happy holiday season. And we will see you in the next year.
Let me just quickly say that Elodie had a question about which sunflower we used. And I don't, off the top of my head, know the answer there. But I will try to find that out. And I will send it to Erin, and she can share it around. Or I'll add it as like a last slide, just a little chat box. By the way, the sunflower was X when I send that over to you. Okay, so everybody will have it.
Perfect. Thank you. And then also before we leave, we do want to make sure that everyone comes on Saturday to Tarzana, to Baker's Acres for SoCal Hort's horticultural yard sale. So it'll be from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Come early because we don't have any idea how quickly these plants will go. We're getting a lot of great items from different board members as well. There'll be tons to choose from, but make sure to come early and take your finds. So you can go to our website, socalhort.org, for more information, to get the address as well. And we will see you this Saturday in person, and then next year virtually. So have a good night, everyone. Thank you again. And if you have any questions, always feel free to reach out.
And email me, or would be fine. I'm happy to answer questions or continue the conversation. Thanks for being such a great audience. We really loved it.
Thank you, Lucinda. Have a good night, everyone.